Can you take me to my friend Julie's house, please?
Sure.
Who are you making eyes at?
That's Sophie. She's my best friend.
Tell me the story of us.
Again?
Are you gonna study abroad there?
Oh, no, I'm not a student. There's no more abroad.
I can't believe childhood is over. It was going to end one way or another.
It wasn't that long ago that I went here. I'm only 27.
A friend of mine desired me to offer a story by her. She wrote it.
Tell her to make it short and spicy. And if the main character is a girl, make sure she's married by the end. Or dead.
The work of Greta Gerwig has a particular way of positioning romanticized ideals of characters against the reality of their experiences. And this subversion of genre is something she uses throughout her body of work.
Because I feel like it just totally captures a very particular feeling of being lost in a foreign city, having this romantic idea of what your experience is going to be, and then the reality of it, just being bored and eating some terrible restaurant, and then going to see Puss in Boots.
Hello. When did Puss in Boots start?
It's when did Puss in Boots start? She's not even gonna see it from the beginning.
Her most recent work on Barbie takes this central fascination and kicks it into high gear. Since the film has only recently been released, this video will be spoiler-free. But from the opening's elaborate homage to Stanley Kubrick's 2001 A Space Odyssey, Gerwig clearly signals to the audience, with a playful wink and nod, that there's more going on here. Just as the signature plastic pink pastiche of Barbie conceals a deeper message within,
she's not dead, she's just having an existential crisis.
So too does her solo directorial debut, Lady Bird, disguise its true intent. Ostensibly, it's a teenage coming-of-age story, but that is only the story in Lady Bird's head.
You ready to go home?
This entire film places Lady Bird within the psychology of that genre, but the film itself is definitely not that.
I think for me, it was as Greta says that like the movie that's going on in Lady Bird's head is not the movie that we're watching.
I wanted the movies in your head to be like John Hughes movies, romantic movies, because we had this thing of, like she thinks the movie, she knows how the movie ends, is there's one right guy and she's gonna get him. And the movie is not that movie, but that romantic idealization was what I kind of wanted to go for.
I guess that's my date.
You aren't gonna get in the car with a guy who honks, are you?
I think, yes, I am.
It's like we can't get out of high school without having one boy who shows up with the car or the boombox or the rose. And I love those movies. I love Say Anything. I love Pretty in Pink. I love 16 Candles. I love the modern versions of them too. But I feel like that's not what life is like.
Shotgun. You look really nice, Kyle.
You look good.
Thanks.
This type of filmmaking is not new for Gerwig. As co-writer of the 2012 film Frances Ha, she again plays with the audience's expectations within the romantic film genre.
Frances Ha specifically, we at a certain point put a there's a few different structures going on, but one of them is, let's tell it like a classic love story.
You want to hear something hilarious?
Yes.
Lev thinks we're gonna end up married.
By placing this exchange early in the film, it sets up the movie as a potential love story between Benji and Frances. Frances even discusses her own romantic ideas about love at the midpoint of the film.
It's that thing when you're with someone and you love them and they know it and they love you and you know it and you look across the room and catch each other's eyes.
Hey, that was great.
Oh, thanks, Ben.
This feels like a setup for the moment when Frances will lock eyes with her person at the film's end, another guy-meets-girl story. But when the payoff for this earlier scene comes, it's actually between her and her best friend, Sophie.
That is your person in this life. And it's funny and sad, but only because this life will end, and it's the secret world that exists right there in public, unnoticed, that no one else knows about.
She has the girl, she loses the girl, she tries to get the girl back. Like that it was kind of almost like a rom-com, but it was with a girl.
That's what I want out of a relationship. Or just life, I guess. Love. Blah. I sound stoned. I'm not stoned.
Perhaps the most meta version of pitting our expectations against reality plays out in her 2019 film Little Women. Here, we expect Jo will end up with Mr. Bear, because this is how every incarnation and the book itself ends. And Gerwig does give us a scene, but she subverts it.
I don't want you to leave. I want you to stay.
You do?
Yes.
But I would never leave if you wish me to stay.
No, I want you to stay.
I have nothing to give you, Jo.
It doesn't matter.
My hands are empty.
They're not empty.
I think what I was interested in doing was, let me see if I can explain this, almost like having my cake and eating it too.
We're given the ending we know from Little Women the novel, but with the cross of the 180 degree line, we go from this shot to this. And in that cross, Gerwig is able to give Louisa May Alcott the ending she truly wanted. We expected Jo would get the guy, but in reality, Gerwig gives her something greater, her book.
I love it. It's romantic. It's very moving. That's very emotional.
Well, thank you.
I wanted to kind of reverse engineer the movie so that the last thing that you saw is that girl getting her book. Because to me, that's the image that in cinema isn't usually associated with, you know, the kind of visceral satisfaction of a kiss. But it could be, it should be, that it's not girl gets boy, it's girl gets book.
It's just about our little life. Well, who will be interested in a story of domestic struggles and joys? It doesn't have any real importance, does it?
Maybe it doesn't seem important because people don't write about them.
No, writing doesn't confer importance, it reflects it.
I don't think so. Writing them will make them more important.
Gerwig understands that the stories she tells matter, that whose story she tells matters.
I'm not interested in a hierarchy of lives. I think I think something I think about a lot is, well, particularly with women's stories, I think there tends to be an idea that maybe they're not as epic, but I've always said, you know, there's just as much epicness in kitchens as there are in battlefields. It's the same.
So much of Gerwig's work focuses on the thematic throughline of becoming. The screenplay for Little Women states this condition twice, just on page 3. The mythic notion of becoming complete or whole by the end of a journey is not a new concept. But in Gerwig's hands, this arc of growing up, of occupying personhood, often results in a radical self-acceptance of the messy complexities of life. And so we get scenes like this, or as she writes in her screenplay for Little Women, not lady running, flat out running, for the joy of it. This idea really isn't radical at all, but that this narrative is the central plot of a film kind of is.
I think a lot of plots, like what people think of as plots, like classic structures, are really male stories. That's a generalization that I'm not sure I want to stand behind, but I do think that there is something there, and I feel like I'm constantly searching for these different narratives. There's a lot of female-centric myths in Native American traditions, actually, and you know the classic, like, George Lucas reading, like, Joseph Campbell, like the
right,
all of
yeah.
that stuff, and they're all like the hero myths. They're all guys, which makes sense. But I was like, well, I went back and I read Joseph Campbell, and I was like, where are the lady myths? And it's tricky. There aren't as many, and they're not quite as tidy.
Sure, you could cram the contours of Gerwig's films into some semblance of the monomyth outlined in Campbell's hero's journey, make them roughly follow Blake Snyder's 15 steps, or identify the rising action, turning points, and reversal sketched out by McKee. But I would argue Gerwig is crafting something very different. In the same way that she subverts genre, Gerwig also subverts structure.
I am not being manipulated through the structure in a way that I will arrive in that place that I feel like in a lot of films that are traditionally romantic comedies or dramedies or whatever it is.
When I write now, it's still a version of like moments, and then I start like building out.
Part of her structuring involves starting with scenes or moments that she feels could make a movie. For Frances Ha, this meant
things like trying to decide whether you want to pay the fee on the ATM.
Or thinking of lines that she would want to see in a film.
Actually, one of the very first scenes I wrote in the movie was someone at a party in college saying, oh, where are you from?
Where are you from?
Sacramento.
Sorry, where?
San Francisco.
When Lady Bird says, I'm from San Francisco, I wanted the audience to say, oh, no, we know all the people you just sold out.
So the structure actually comes later.
Yeah, I never structure before. But I believe in structure, but I only really find it through, it's like it has to be built like a honeycomb or something. It has to be built underneath it. It has to be all interconnected. Otherwise, it feels like it's like a thing put on top of it.
First, she gathers her materials, in this case, her page count.
But I write too much, so I'll wind up with like way, way, way too much material.
Early drafts of Lady Bird were over 350 pages under the working title Mothers and Daughters, and Little Women was honed down from 400 pages. She then sees where the structure is. It's not predetermined, and only then does she start to weave it all together. And in her crafting, she creates something deeply personal.
It both mirrors what I go through because you're always making something that's away from you but part of you. And then, you know, the scene of her selling trying to sell a story, I took that almost verbatim from the book because, I know exactly what that is to sit in front of somebody and try to sell them a story. And they're telling me I need to make changes, and I'm figuring out how many changes I can make and still live with myself, but I need the money.
I think this is changing, and it's, you know, different now. But I think, you know, there was sort of a thing, I think especially when I was growing up, like if you're a boy who wrote a lot, people might say, well, you might want to be a writer. And if you were a girl who wrote a lot, they say, well, why did you have this diary with a lock and key and never show anybody what's inside? And it's like, lock it away. I thought, gosh, that's such a weird message to lock it up.
I always hear about guys whose parents got them little Super 8 cameras and they started making films. And I'm sure my parents would have gotten me them if I had asked for it, but it wasn't something that you gave girls as much. Mm. But what I did was put on plays with everyone I knew.
I wanted to be a playwright, and then I got rejected from
Yale,
NYU, and Juilliard in playwriting.
For graduate?
For graduate school.
Okay, I got something. This will cheer you up.
It was this desire, a desire to be a storyteller at any capacity, that led her to a particular kind of filmmaking.
I mean, the luckiest thing that happened to me was that I found a group of people who were really making their own stuff.
There's the term, and I don't know how you feel about it, which is mumblecore.
Are you talking about
I shouldn't have said that word. I know. I almost said it.
You know, I think the word itself is really annoying. So I would say, yes, I do. I don't hate it, but it's not the
You don't go coolest. Around saying it to people.
Yeah, I don't have a mumblecore tattoo.
They were just going out with the cameras they had, with the money they could scrounge up, and just shooting and getting better and figuring out how to construct things. And that was just incredibly helpful because I hadn't gone to film school, so it was my beginning of what was my film school.
The most massive tragedy is that nobody like really actually listens to each other. Yeah. It's every like going like this. They're just like, everybody's in love with the wrong person, and nobody actually like hears what anybody else is saying ever.
But contrary to the improvisational way in which these films were made, she never lost her love of the written text that is so essential to theater.
And I think when I read Noah's movie Greenberg, I had this kind of instant flash of like, I didn't write that, but I wish I had.
You like old things.
A shrink said to me once, I have trouble living in the present, so I linger on the past because I felt like I never really lived it in the first place, you know?
The way I write and the way I've written with Noah is that the script is really a pretty set document, and you don't change anything. You don't change any of the words. There's no improv.
There's no improv.
No. It's notable, too, because I feel like the kind of writing I like is the kind of writing that one might think is improv.
Yes.
Like, Kenneth Lonergan, his writing does not sound like writing, but it definitely is writing.
Similar to how Gerwig subverts genre and structure, she also subverts the form of film itself by drawing on her roots in theater.
In theater, you can genuinely create a moment that feels like, is this supposed to be happening? And in film, you can never totally get that because people know, well, the filmmakers have watched this a million times. They've cut it, they've chosen where the edit points are, they know what it is, so this can't really be a mistake. I mean, in Francis says,
I like things that look like mistakes.
And I would say that is the closest thing to me having a mouthpiece.
So how do you recapture the mistake in a form that's so pre-planned? Well, for Gerwig, you do lots of takes.
I'm not like a Fincher take person. Like, it's not hundreds, but I do like to do a lot of them. And I do a lot of takes. I tend to do a lot of takes, actually, because I always like to see where actors go after they get bored with their own ideas.
I'm thinking particularly if there's a scene. Sophie comes over to this apartment I'm living at with the boys for the first time, and I come in and I put a record in its place and I talk to her and then I go get us whiskeys and I come back around. I think we did that like over 35 times.
For Gerwig, repetition leads to something more truthful, a subconscious spontaneity that can sometimes get lost in the filmmaking process.
Why did you do that many takes? Like, what?
It's like being on a drug. It makes sense when you're on it.
We wanted it to feel light on its feet, but we also wanted it to be as perfect as possible. And I think that's, you just have to do it a lot to make it feel that effervescent.
And in her crafting, rhythm plays a central role.
Because I think in film, editing establishes the rhythm, and in theater, language establishes the rhythm. And I'm sort of a weird hybrid, because I like language to establish the rhythm, and then the editing to sort of like play a counterbeat. But it's a hard thing to totally describe to someone. I'm like, I don't want you to disrupt the rhythm that's happening, but I want it to be a syncopation with what's happening.
And to create this syncopation, she again draws on theater.
There's a playwright I really love, Carol Churchill, who does great overlapping dialogue, and the way she indicates overlapping dialogue with there's a slash, and then you're like, this person starts while this person finishes this line. Like, that sense of creating a cacophony deliberately is something that I've always loved.
That's not something that you really see in period pieces.
Hey, such despicable,
like the strong words that mean something.
Well, I have to go back to school and I don't have any lines.
It's scripted in a way that a play would be, where she uses dashes, and it just makes it quite musical.
So much of it is how it sounds to me.
Is it fairies?
Santa Claus.
No, it's Old Aunt March.
Mr. Lawrence sent it.
Lawrence plays grandfather?
Yes.
I hear the way, it's like I don't know the performances exactly, I just hear the rhythm of the words in my head while I'm writing, and I'm always listening for that to drop in. Sometimes I won't even look, I'll just listen, and then I'll hear it, and then I'm like, oh, that was the one. It's actually kind of one of my favorite things in I mean, in theater or in film, when you just, it's everybody missing each other.
We went to college together and we're the same person.
Oh, you're that Francis.
But we have different hair.
Who's Thomas? And
that's what we say. Yeah, I'm that Francis.
You should know she speaks so highly of you.
Well, we're best friends. She's been to my house for Christmas 3 times.
Why doesn't she go to her own house?
She's Jewish.
She was just saying last week how much she loved you.
You saw her last week.
When did you fuck her brother?
Where were you guys?
I met you last night.
And you're like, oh, you guys are just not connecting. And I think I've always been interested in the way people miss each other.
With its roots in theater, overlapping dialogue sounds truer to life and how people really speak. It creates conversations that don't feel written.
It's very rare to find real, three-dimensional, complex, vulnerable, but also guarded characters in movies today.
In this way, Gerwig creates films that feel real. They're written in a way that somehow feels more true to life, structured in a way that feels wholly new, and created with a rhythm all their own. And if there was ever any doubt about Gerwig's unique perspective,
the most massive tragedy is that nobody like really actually listens to each other. Yeah. It's ever like going like this.
It's been there from the start.